Good morning and welcome to worship. Let's begin this morning by centering ourselves in this beautiful song, Jesus' Name Above All Names. I'm going to ask Cindy to play it twice, and then as we're singing it or humming it or just listening to it and reading the words to this beautiful song, let the Spirit fill you so that you're prepared for worship this morning. Jesus' Name Above All Names. This morning, who are joining us for worship this morning, either through our YouTube channel live stream, or if you're out in the parking lot or nearby and you're able to hear us on 107.3 FM, we welcome all of you today as we worship together and bring praise and glory to God. Let's sing our first hymn together. I sing the Almighty Power of God. And flawed though we are, we too delight in your beloved Son. As in his name we gather in the house of many praises, may the heavens be open to us, that we may catch a glimpse of that light and love that transforms our common days with a beauty not of our making, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Talk to you about baptism this morning. We considered how important water is. What do we do with water? We have to drink it so that we're not dehydrated, so that we don't get dried out. We bathe in it so that we're not dirty but clean. We cook in it. I know that myself, when I'm making hot dogs at home, that I prefer to boil them rather than to cook them any other way. So water is important. But we're also baptized in water. The question is why? Well, for two reasons. First, to remember how Christ was baptized. Not that he was baptized because he was sinful, but he was baptized so that we could identify with him, so that we could know who he is in our lives. And so we are baptized as a mark of that relationship with Christ through the Holy Spirit. And in that mark of knowing who Christ is in our lives, we're not dried out in the Spirit. We are cleansed and made clean from our sin. And we know what it means to have Christ in our lives and walk with him. So when you're looking at water, when you're getting a drink of water, when you're thinking about water, think of that. Think of the baptism that's with you, your baptism, that shows that you, through the Spirit in your life, from that moment to now, through the rest of your life, that you are a child of God, beloved in Jesus. Our scripture lesson this morning is from the Old Testament book of Genesis, beginning at chapter 1 at verse 1. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. And God said, "Let there be light." And there was light. And God saw the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night, and there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. If you are able, I would ask that you stand for the gospel lesson for this morning. Our gospel lesson is the gospel according to St. Mark, found in chapter 1, verses 4 to 11. John the baptizer appeared in the wilderness proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And the people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and being baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart, and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven saying, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Would you pray with me and for me this morning? Breathe on me, breath of God, till I am wholly thine, till all this earthly part of me Close with thy fire divine. Breathe in me, O Spirit, breathe on me, breathe through me, that I might speak your word this day, O God, that I might proclaim your message. Fill me and renew me today, that I might bring the message you've given me this week. So with ears and hearts ready to receive, we may hear your message and heed it in our hearts and live it as disciples ready to bring the hope and the life and the peace of Jesus to our world. By your Spirit, we pray that the words that come from my mouth, that the meditations that come from our hearts, will be acceptable to you, Lord, our Rock and our Redeemer. Amen. In the season of Epiphany, Jesus is revealed to us as light, that by his light, we can be light for the world. How important is light? Especially when you're in the dark and you want to see. When Angie and I were first married, we lived in a small four-room apartment. Actually, it was three rooms and a storage room in Harrisburg on State Street. And I went to work one afternoon, and she was home. And when I came home, it was dark, and the apartment was dark. So I went upstairs the back way into the kitchen, and I didn't turn any lights on. I thought I'd just walk through to the bedroom. Unbeknownst to me, someone had been busy, and when I turned the corner and started across the living room, something hit my knees. It was our couch, and suddenly I fell on my wife, who was asleep. She had rearranged the furniture on me and hadn't told me. And I looked at her, and she looked at me, and I said, "Did you get bored today, dear?" Had I just turned the light on, I would have seen what she had done, but I didn't. And I stumbled and I fell in the dark, and a wonderful family story was born. But you see, we need light. We need to be able to see with the light. A fella wants to go home. He's been working long hours and he's had enough, but he can't go home yet. His shift isn't over, and he finally says to his coworker, "I've had enough. I can't do this anymore." He says, "But I got an idea." He climbs up on his desk and he removes one of the panels for the lights, and he pulls the rod lights down, and then he gets up and wraps his feet and his legs around the fixture and hangs there. His boss comes out and he says, "What do you think you're doing?" And he says, kind of crazily, "I'm a light bulb." Boss says, "You've been working too long and too hard." He says, "Go home. I don't want to see you for 2 days." He gets down and he starts out, and the guy, his co-worker next to him, packs his things up and starts after him. And the boss says, "Wait a minute, I didn't tell you you could go anywhere. Where are you going?" And the co-worker looks at him and says, "Well, I can't work in the dark, can I?" We're all affected by light. From light, plants grow. From light, we receive warmth. From light, we can see where we're going. From light, we're not afraid anymore. Light is important. It's an important part of our life. We have to have light. Paulo Coelho said that the purpose of light is to create more light, to open people's eyes, to reveal the marvels around us. Really, to get us out of the dark, the physical dark that brings uncertainty and fear, and the spiritual dark that holds us back and keeps us from growing. Excuse me. Light helps us to see the day, to see truth, to see hope, to see life. And as Christians, we believe that we see God in Christ Jesus by the light that is given in God, so that we see who God is and who we are in God through Christ, and live for him as we shine his light in the world. God brings that light. That's how it's been from the beginning. God creates everything in light. Genesis says, "In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void
and darkness covered the face of the deep. And a wind from God swept over the face of the waters, and God said, let there be light, and there was light. God separating the light, he saw that it was good. He called the light day, and he called the darkness night, evening, morning, the first day. That wind, ruach in Hebrew, pneuma in Greek, God's wind, his spirit, sweeps over the formless void of darkness, the gulf of nothingness, and out of ex nihilo, out of nothingness, light dawns. From light comes life. God calls forth light from the light, bringing forth that life. Light that shines out of darkness so that all can come into being and exist. The Holy Spirit overshadows the darkness, and light comes so life can come out of disorder into the order that comes in God, which unfolds then as you read the rest of Genesis 1 and 2. By the Spirit's movement and in the power of God through the Spirit, light comes so that all may have life, that all things and all people can be created and exist. Then and now. In God's light, the world is made and continues to be made to God's glory, and we see that light. It shines in our hearts so that we know life that God gives and light that God shines for us, that by God's light we are enlightened more than just knowing the light. It is part of who we are in God who creates us, because we're drawn to that light in Jesus, drawn to its life, drawn to its hope, drawn to its purpose in Christ. Drawn to the light. It's like the fellow that goes to the cardiologist. And the doctor says to him, what's the matter? He says, I think I'm a moth. He says, you think you're a moth and you came to a cardiologist? Don't you think you should go to the psychiatrist next door? He says, I suppose I should. He said, well, why did you come to me? And the guy said, because your light is on. And we are drawn to that light in Jesus so that it can shine in our hearts, so that it can illuminate our lives. Why? Because Jesus came as Messiah so that all may shine in him. That by his life we are enlightened, and in that enlightenment, in that light, we can see Jesus. We can know him. We can love him. We can shine for him. Ralph Milton wrote, God provides the light of the sun and the light of Christ, without which life would not be possible. Jesus came to bring life and life abundant, life in the power of the Holy Spirit, to draw people to him so the light can shine. In Mark, the baptizer appears in the wilderness. He proclaims a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. That is, that you come, you confess your sin, you are baptized in the Jordan, and you are cleansed of that sin. And the people from Judea, the whole countryside, from Jerusalem, they all came out, and they were baptized by him in the Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John had a message, and he proclaimed that message. The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I'm not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. And then Jesus appears. In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And the voice from heaven said, you are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased. The Ruach, the wind, the Spirit of God that brooded over the formless void and brought forth light at creation, descends on Jesus at his baptism, and it lights on him so his light can shine. Not that he needed to be baptized for forgiveness of sins. Certainly he did not. He was the sinless one. But he's baptized so people can identify with him and know him and his grace and his life in God, and that his light could shine in every heart. God calls him the beloved, with whom he is well pleased. Because Jesus is the true light, the Messiah, the Son of God. That in him new light can be found, in the light that he shines. The change that John the Baptist speaks about, the Spirit washing over everyone and setting us all on fire in the Spirit, draws us to that light in God. John was looking for the one who would do that. And along comes Jesus. Spirit touched and anointed in God's light, Jesus is baptized so that his light can shine out of the darkness, that the darkness shall dissipate, and God's light would shine in all who are drawn to it, who come to know him and love him and seek his life in their own lives, that his light would shine in them, that his light would shine in you. You are light bringers. You're baptized to be light and to shine that light of Christ and lead people sitting in the darkness of uncertainty and apathy and cruelty and suffering and fear to see this light in Christ. Christ, who is the light of the world, so that you can be light for the world in Jesus. You are the beloved of God in our world. You are the light that shines for God. And how do you do that? In the love that you bring, in the joy that you live, and the peace that you share, and the patience and the generosity you give, and the faithfulness that you have for God, and the self-control in your life that you bring, and how you stay in love with God in your daily life, so that people can see and know the light that you shine, and be the light in God shining in a dark world. Even when all that is counter to God, we saw some of that this week, didn't we? Racism and sexism and violence, taking advantage and much more. Even when that tries to rule in our world, you be the light and shine in the darkness for Jesus. So united by his light, we can shine together for God. We can glow and glorify God and bring his light to the world, that all would know Jesus and have Jesus in their lives. One more story. Little girl goes for a checkup at her pediatrician. And the pediatrician takes a little otoscope, you know what I'm talking about, the little thing he puts in the ear, turns a light on, puts it in the ear, and he says, "Now, am I going to see Popeye in there?" And she just kind of gives him a look. And then he takes the light from the otoscope, and he takes a tongue depressor and pulls down her tongue a little bit and sticks it in and says, "Am I going to see Big Bird in there?" And she just gives him another one of those looks. And then he puts that down, he takes a stethoscope, and he puts it on, and he places the end on her heart. He says, "Am I going to hear Barney in there?" And she looks at him and, just as innocent could be, says, "Barney's on my underpants. Jesus is in my heart." Jesus in our heart. We need to shine for God. Because enlightened in God, you're to shine for God in Jesus. You're to illuminate the dark world in your love, in your peace, in your life, daily. You're to bring that light and to shine it as baptized brothers and sisters who live in the light from your hearts to the world out there as light bringers. Be a light bringer. Shine that light of Jesus that you're drawn to in a dark world that needs you, and let it illuminate the darkness, so that all who sit in the dark can see the light, come home to God, and live for Jesus. In him there is no darkness at all, the night and the day. us, Lord, that you who are the light of the world can find in us light that shines for the world in you, that we could be light bringers, those who in our love, in our peace, in our patience, in our generosity, in our faithfulness, in our self-control, can shine the light of Christ to the world, letting people see that light who sit in the darkness, so that they can come home and know your light and live for you. Help us to shine. Shine in a dark world, that it will be enlightened and illuminated in Jesus, and shine for all to see. We pray this in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Just a few items to take care of this morning, and then we'll move on to prayer. Please remember that we are now in a time of COVID-19, and right now we are not meeting in person for worship, and our church council will meet tomorrow night to discuss how we are going to be able to go back to in-person worship, or how to stay where we are now. The bishop has asked that we at least stay to the end of January, and we'll have to talk about that tomorrow. But there are services still, and of course we're doing that through the wonderful technology that we have, and we're able to live stream on our YouTube channel. And you're able to come, if you wish, in the comfort of your car to the church parking lot, accompanied by fellow worshipers in their cars, and turn your radio to 107.3 FM at 10:15 for both of those. And so, and of course, when a live stream is finished, then it's posted on YouTube and posted on Facebook. So if you can watch it later, that would be wonderful too. So there are offerings of worship, and we continue to do that. But we'll let you know as a council how we wish to proceed for the next few weeks. Now, in light of that, keep in mind that we rely on God's tithes and offerings to help keep the ministries of our church up and running. And so you can mail your check to the church address, P.O. Box 387 Beach Lake, or deliver it to the church office Tuesday through Thursday, 9 to 3. Or if you want to contact the church office for the name of a financial team member who you confidentially can be assured that your contribution can be received and delivered, you can do that as well. If you'd like to make an offering towards Sunday school or Christian education, you can do that as well and write on the check Sunday school in the memo line so that we know what it's for. We are in the process of trying to replace one of two of our furnaces, because it's rusting out, it's leaking, and the cost of that will be $7,965, and we're asking that you consider tithing and or gifting towards this major expense for our building fund, and it dramatically is impacted by this amount. So if you can do that, please do so. You can see the trustees to do that. Our membership audit committee is forming. If you wish to be on that, please see Beth Troop and or me or our church secretary Jean, and we'll put you on. We're trying to update our membership information for the ICON information system. There is an offering from Gary Shockley, who's our equipping vital congregations director. He's going to do a presentation on simplified accountability structure, which we're looking at, and I'm going to take that just as a refresher for me, but if you'd like to do so, you can register in the web address that is listed here. Today is, no, next week is Human Relations Day, Sunday, and we celebrate Human Relations Sunday before the official observance of Martin Luther King's birthday.
You're invited to become part of this by writing a check to Human Relations Day and placing it in an envelope, and be sure that we get that. This week, a few things that will be going on. Trustees tomorrow night at 7 by conference call. Church Council at 7 on Tuesday by Zoom. And, of course, our Wednesday morning prayer breakfast at the Country Cafe at 9 a.m. and our prayer group at 5:30 on Wednesday. I think that's about it for today as far as announcements. Now, prayer time. Let's prepare our hearts for prayer. There is much to be in prayer for today. First off, Evelyn Dillmuth and Jada Wilcox and Paul Van Horn II all are in need of prayer, continued prayer, as are the families of Alan Branning and Bernard Cosgrove. We also are praying for those affected by COVID, whether they are patients or family. We want to be in prayer for those folks. But I think most of all, we need to be in prayer for our country. We all saw what happened Wednesday. Cooler heads did not prevail. We need to be in prayer. Because God guides us as a country, I think, sometimes. And I believe that we need to be in prayer that democracy will continue, that we will be a country that will be able to lead the world in knowing what it means to have a voice at the table. Please pray. Pray for the coming week. Pray for next week, especially on the inauguration. There have been rumors of further violence and further outbreaks of violence on Inauguration Day. I'm praying that that will not happen. Again, that cooler heads will prevail. Pray for our country. Pray for our outgoing president, Mr. Trump, as he makes his transition, and for our incoming president, Mr. Biden, as he begins his term as president. I'm not political most of the time. I try to shy away from that kind of thing. But I really believe that we need to pray for our country and pray for the people of our country. Pray for our leadership who were in danger on Wednesday. And pray for those who are wanting to cause harm and violence against our leadership because they don't agree, that they will see a different light and move in a different direction. Sermon done, mini sermon done, but let's be in prayer for our country and for the circumstances of our world. I'm sure there are others that you're praying for, people that you probably have in mind. If you do, I'll ask in this moment of silence if you'll just mention their name out loud. Peter, Dennis Vermilia, my mother and father. Let us pray. Lord, hear us as we pray today, because we know you're in control. We know that ultimately you have all the power, we have none. All power comes from you. This is what Jesus said to Pilate. Help us not to worry, help us not to fear, but just to trust in you, to know that you lead, to know that you are there to help, to comfort, and to guide, to strengthen, to renew, to be with us even in the darkest hours. We ask you, bless those that are living in the darkness now, the darkness of illness, the darkness of hatred, the darkness of fear, the darkness of division. Help them see light and to know light, to not be afraid, but to trust and follow where you lead. To trust and follow where your light shines, so that they can know that hope, so that they can find that peace, so that they can live in that grace, that love, that powerful life in you. Touch those that are in need of healing today. Make them whole, make them new, walk with them today, Lord. Comfort those that are going through difficult days because of a loved one who's going through difficult days. Strengthen all of us, Lord, to follow where you lead us, not where we want to lead ourselves, but where you lead us, so that we're able to know your love and follow your love and live in your love each day. Guide us today. Walk with us today. Be with us today as your church moves beyond the building out into the world to reach lives, to touch lives, to help people to know your love, to know that they are beloved, and that they don't have to be in the darkness, that the light can shine in their lives too. They just turn to you through Jesus Christ in their lives, so that they let that light shine in their heart, so that they can shine for Jesus in the world. Guide our hearts and minds each day. Give us the strength we need to do what you call us to do in ministry. Bless us to be your people here at Beach Lake United Methodist Church, that we may continue to reach out and help others to know you, to love you, and to seek to serve you in the powerful life in Christ Jesus through the Holy Spirit. For it is in Jesus that we pray, and he has taught us to pray together by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory forever. As we close our service, let's do so with the hymn, Christ, whose glory fills the skies.